Now let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, TJ Manotok.
Good morning to friends of The Rundown. I'm TJ Manotok with your headlines from the North American region.
We begin with U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris securing enough votes to win the Democratic presidential nomination on Friday, according to Democratic National Committee Chair Jamie Harrison. During the first day of casting virtual ballots for the nomination, Harris already received the support of more than 50% of all delegates. Harris, who joined the virtual event, said she will formally accept the nomination next week once the virtual voting period is closed. Harris will become the first Black woman and first Asian American to lead a major party ticket. If she defeats Donald Trump, the Republican nominee, in November, she would be America's first female president. The only Filipino-American in U.S. Congress, Virginia's Bobby Scott, reminded voters that while switching from President Joe Biden to Harris was last minute, there's no major change in strategies.
One of the good things about switching from Biden to Harris, when we switch, we didn't have to change the message. We can still talk about this administration has produced the most jobs in 4 years, most jobs in 4 years than any administration in history.
Meanwhile, after serving five U.S. presidents for nearly 30 years, Filipina executive chef at the White House, Cristeta Comerford, has decided to retire. The 61-year-old Manileña became the first woman to become the executive chef at the White House and the first minority, the first Filipino-American to hold the position. The Filipino chef served Presidents Bill Clinton, George Bush, Barack Obama, Donald Trump, and Joe Biden and their first families. Comerford first worked at the White House as an assistant chef in 1995 under President Clinton, but it was First Lady Laura Bush who appointed her to the executive chef position in 2005. In past Filipino-American History Month celebrations at the White House, Comerford revealed that great cooks run in her family.
My first food memories and experiences came from my Lola. I grew up in Bulacan, and they're well known for their great cuisine and great cooking, all the women helping in the kitchen and cooking together. My dad's hometown is Batangas, which is the other way around. It's only men that are allowed to do cooking, so the women are not allowed to help out in the kitchen. So I get both of these beautiful worlds of my father and my mother. So naturally, just by way of like, you know, deduction, okay, I have two great cooks that has really honed me into this person that I am today.
As the White House executive chef, Comerford's responsibilities included designing and executing menus for state dinners, social events, holiday receptions, and official lunches hosted by presidents and first ladies, as well as the daily first family meals.
And those are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. You can catch more of our TFC News on our ABS-CBN News website and YouTube channel. I'm TJ Manotok. Back to our friends at The Rundown.
The White House says the additional military assets being deployed in the Middle East are a defensive measure aimed at de-escalating tensions. The Pentagon said on Friday it would deploy additional fighter jets and Navy warships to the region. National Security Council spokesperson John Kirby also says the U.S. continues to help Israel prepare for an anticipated response by Iran after the assassination of Hamas leader Ismail Haniyeh in Tehran.
Look, when the Supreme Leader says he's going to avenge, we have to take that seriously. Now, I don't know what they're going to do or when they're going to do it, but we got to make darn sure that we're ready and that we have the capabilities in the region to be able to help Israel defend itself and, quite frankly, defend our own people, our own facilities, our own nationals.
Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu laying the blame on Hamas for a long-stalled Gaza ceasefire deal. Speaking at the start of a weekly cabinet meeting, Netanyahu said that while Israel has agreed to the initial outline of a deal, Hamas continues to demand more changes.
It does not back down from its demand that Israel cannot return to war. It demands from us to withdraw from the Philadelphia corridor and the Rafah crossing, its lifeline that will allow it to rearm and again grow stronger. It's important to establish the principle. We are not leaving there. Hamas is also not willing to allow any mechanism that would check and prevent the passage of weapons and terrorists to the northern Gaza Strip. It is doing all this because it wants to rehabilitate and recover and repeat again and again the October 7 massacre, as it has promised to do.
Cross-border fire between Israel and Hamas continued on Sunday after diplomatic efforts in Cairo on Saturday ended without progress. Israel also bracing for a serious escalation in its northern border with Lebanon following the killing of a Hezbollah commander in Beirut. Multiple countries, including the U.S., the U.K., Sweden, and Jordan, have advised their citizens to leave the country amid escalating tensions. British Prime Minister Keir Starmer condemns anti-immigration protests that have erupted in towns and cities across Britain. The violence was triggered by killings of three girls in a knife attack in Southport last week. The murders were seized on by anti-immigrant and anti-Muslim groups as misinformation spread that the suspected attacker was an immigrant and a radical Islamist. Violence intensified in Rotherham Sunday as hundreds gathered by a hotel housing asylum seekers.
I utterly condemn the far-right thuggery we've seen this weekend. Be in no doubt, those that have participated in this violence will face the full force of the law. The police will be making arrests, individuals will be held on remand, charges will follow, and convictions will follow. If you target people because of the colour of their skin or their faith, then that is far right, and I'm prepared to say so. But it doesn't matter what apparent motivation there is. This is violence, it is not protest. It doesn't matter what the motivation is. The motivation for the vast majority of people in this country is to see their streets safe. And that's what I'm determined that we will deliver.
Police have said the 17-year-old suspect was born in Britain and are not threatening and are not treating it as a terrorist incident. At least 91 people were killed and hundreds injured in clashes in Bangladesh as tens of thousands of protesters gathered to call for the resignation of Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina. The death toll, which includes at least 13 policemen, was the highest for a single day from any protest in Bangladesh's recent history. It surpasses the 67 deaths reported on July 19, when students took to the streets to demand the scrapping of quotas for government jobs. The government has declared an indefinite nationwide curfew and announced a three-day general holiday starting Monday. The unrest is Hasina's biggest test in her 20-year regime after she won a fourth straight term in elections that were boycotted by the main opposition party.